Hello everyone, welcome back to my course. This is our 10th lecture. In this lecture, we will study the actor-critic methods. This is the map of our course. After a long journey, we have finally reached the last stop, which is the 10th lecture. Although it is the final lecture, its importance is extremely high. Of course, every part of the course is important, but the earlier and later lectures have different kinds of significance. The earlier lectures are important because they provide the foundational concepts, for example, of the Bellman equation, the Bellman optimality equation, and so on. If these are not clearly understood, it will be difficult for you to learn the later content. On the other hand, the later lectures are important because they get closer to more advanced methods and practical applications. For instance, the actor-critic method I will introduce today is one of the most popular methods in reinforcement learning nowadays. So, what exactly is the actor-critic method? In fact, it is not a completely new method. It is essentially a variant of the policy gradient method that we studied in the previous lecture. So why is it called by a different name? The reason is that it incorporates value-based methods, especially value function approximation, into the policy gradient framework. I will talk about the details in today's lecture. This is what I just mentioned, and I will not repeat it again. What do the terms actor and critic mean? First, the actor refers to the policy update step. Why is it called the actor? The policy is responsible for taking action. Therefore, the entity that takes action can be thought of as the actor. Second, what does the critic mean? The term critic literally means a reviewer or a judge. Here, the critic is responsible for policy evaluation. That is, I have a policy and I want to assess whether it is good or not. I can do so by estimating the action value or the state value. This process is called critic. This is the outline for today's lecture. First, I will introduce a very simple actor-critic algorithm. From now on, I may refer to actor-critic as AC. While this AC algorithm is quite simple, it plays a crucial role in revealing the core idea behind the actor-critic method. Building on this, I will then introduce the advantage actor-critic method, abbreviated as A2C. The core idea of A2C is to reduce the variance of the estimate by introducing a baseline. Next, I will extend this technique further by showing how to transform an on-policy actor-critic method into off-policy. This requires a very important technique called importance sampling. These three topics are interconnected. The later topics are extensions of the earlier ones. They also share a common characteristic. Just like in the previous lecture, the policies here are all stochastic. Can we use deterministic policies? Yes, we can. In the final section, I will introduce a deterministic actor-critic method. Now let's look at the first part that is about the simplest actor-critic algorithm. To understand this, we first need to revisit the policy gradient method we studied in the previous lecture. The revisit is important because, as I mentioned earlier, the actor-critic method is essentially a type of policy gradient methods. The basic idea of policy gradient is as follows. First, we have an objective function, which can be the average value v pi bar or the average reward r pi bar. The second step is to optimize this objective function. How do we do this? We can use the simplest gradient method, gradient ascent, theta t plus 1 equals theta t plus alpha delta theta j of theta t. What is this gradient? Its expression is here, and we already learned it in the previous lecture. The third step is to transform the algorithm that contains an expectation into an algorithm that does not. This gives us a stochastic gradient ascent algorithm. This expression is very important. Why? Because through this expression, we can clearly identify which part is the actor and which is the critic, as well as how the actor and critic are combined. It's very intuitive. So, which part is the actor? The algorithm itself is the actor. What does the actor do? The actor updates the policy. Since the parameters are those of the policy, changing them would change the policy. Therefore, the actor is this algorithm that updates the policy. What is the critic? The critic is the algorithm that estimates the action value Qt. Specifically, to update the policy, we need this value, which is an estimate of the action value Qpi. Therefore, the critic's role is to evaluate the current policy and compute the corresponding action value. In summary, by looking at this expression, we can clearly see how the actor and critic, as well as policy-based and value-based methods, are combined. Let's move on. How to get action value QT. So far, we have studied two methods to estimate action values. The first is the Monte Carlo method. Specifically, to calculate the action value, we start by collecting an episode and then compute the return for that episode. We use this return as an estimate of the action value. This is the basic idea of the Monte Carlo method. If the action value is calculated this way and we combine it with the algorithm we just discussed, the entire algorithm is called reinforce, or Monte Carlo policy gradient, which we have introduced in the previous lecture. The second method to estimate action values is temporal difference learning, which is the focus of today's lecture. When we use the TD method to estimate action values, the algorithm is usually called Actor-Critic. Now, we are ready to introduce the first simplest Actor-Critic algorithm. The goal of this algorithm is to optimize the objective function j theta. How do we do this? At time step t, assuming the current state is st and the current policy corresponds to theta t, we generate an action at based on this policy and interact with the environment. This results in a reward rt plus 1 and a new state st plus 1. In st plus 1, we generate a new action at plus 1 based on the policy in that state. Now we have five samples: st, at, rt plus 1, st plus 1, and at plus 1. These five values form an experience sample. We can then use them in an algorithm to estimate the action value. What algorithm? When you see these five samples, you may remember that they correspond to the SARSA algorithm. So in this case, the critic corresponds to the SARSA algorithm. As shown in the parentheses, I labeled it as value update, because essentially they are the same. Thus, the critic here corresponds to the algorithm of SARSA combined with value function approximation. The SARSA algorithm corresponds to a function with parameters w. When w is updated, we get a new action value q, which is then used in the actor. The actor, as described earlier, is the algorithm that updates the policy. After updating the new policy will be used in the next step to generate new data. Let me add some additional explanations about this algorithm, some of which I have already mentioned. First, the critic corresponds to the algorithm of SARSA with value function approximation. The actor corresponds to the policy update algorithm I introduced earlier. It is important to note that this algorithm is on policy. Why are policy gradient methods, including the Actor-Critic method, on policy? The reason is as follows. The gradient of the objective function j theta is based on an expectation. S belongs to eta and a belongs to pi. Then there's a complex expression after that, which I'll skip for now. To compute this expectation, we need to sample from certain distributions. That is, when using stochastic gradient ascent, the samples must follow these distributions. Therefore, action A must be sampled according to policy pi. As a result, policy pi is both the behavior policy and the target policy, making both the behavior and target policies the same. This is why policy gradient methods, including the actor-critic method, are on policy. Some of you might ask, does being on policy mean that we should make the policy epsilon greedy or use some other random policy? Actually, that's not necessary because the policy here is already stochastic. You may recall that the policy must always assign a positive probability to every action, meaning it has built-in exploration capabilities. Therefore, there's no need to convert it into something like an epsilon greedy policy. The algorithm we just discussed is the simplest actor-critic method, sometimes called QAC. The Q refers to the Q value, which is the action value. While this algorithm is very simple, it reveals the core idea behind actor-critic methods. We will build upon this foundation to explore more advanced variations of the actor-critic method.